This is the brand new Creality CR-6 SE. This is an early beta unit that Creality sent me to evaluate. They've got a Kickstarter pre-sale thing going on. I was able to print a bunch of stuff on it, try out its features like auto level, touchscreen, so I can give you the rundown on this. And I also compared it to an Ender 3. So if you want to know more detail, stick around right here at Filament Friday. Filament Friday is brought to you by these Patreon supporters. Here it is out of the box. You can obviously tell it's mostly assembled, which is nice. Now, the first thing I notice is the aluminum extrusion is smooth on the front and the back. The sides still have a groove for the wheels, but it looks really nice. The back of it, dual lead screws and dual stepper motors. And it also has a belt between the two. I think that's to keep them in sync. The top of the extruder is covered, but it's definitely different than what the stock Ender 3 or CR10 have. Whether it can handle NinjaFlex, I'll have to dig into this and find out. It's got a filament runout sensor, and below that, a junction block for all the connectors, including a single connector that goes from here up to here. So there's a cable for that somewhere, I just gotta find it. The hot end itself is different than the CR10 or Ender 3. I can tell by looking at the back of it, it's different. It's got a silicone sock over the heat block and a unique nozzle. It's a different nozzle than what's on the Ender 3 or CR10. It's got a single fan on the side with ductwork to blow down on the nozzle. And it's got an LED to light it so you can see that first layer going down a lot easier. The fan itself that cools the hot end is a lot smaller. It looks like the one that's on an E3D V6. Hopefully it's a lot quieter. Now this is supposed to also have a strain gauge sensor, so when the nozzle hits the bed, that's how it does auto level. It's a Bowden setup, and whether this PTFE tube goes all the way down, we'll find out. It does have an optical sensor here. You break that with this bracket for Z, but it's got auto level for Z, so I'm not sure the purpose of this. Guess we'll find out. The base itself has an adjustment for the Y belt, and there's an X adjustment up here. That's nice. I've shown that on an Ender 3 video. I like that feature. All the electronics are contained in this box and even has a touchscreen display that goes on the front here. It's got a glass bed and a real wide base, wider than an Ender 3 Pro. It's got a glass bed with a textured top, but you can also remove it. It's got these release locks, so you can lift it up and it's smooth on the bottom, so you can pull it off, and you could probably put a different board on here if you want with, like, say, build tack. But this snaps into clips at the back, and then you just lock it in place. There's no adjustment wheels. It's got all these little spacers in here. In fact, one fell out. I don't know where it goes, but it sets it to a fixed height because it's got auto level, so there's no adjustment there. The electronics itself, the board is up here. It's got a full-size SD card and a micro B connector for the cable. I gotta find that as well. So hopefully I find the two cables, that one and this one. And that's different. Mini B is what's on the Ender 3 and CR10. This is a micro B. And like I said, a full-size SD card, not the tiny one. The power supply is back here because here's a switch for the 230 or 110 volt. I'm told it's a Meanwell. We'll take it apart and find out. The plug is over here and a switch on the side. There's a few connectors to connect up, and then it's machined out for this to fit in with screws to hold it in place. It's got a handle that screws onto the top. They did give me a US cord, which is nice. And this is a spool holder. This is injected molded. It snaps onto the side like this and actually pivots, so you can change the angle if you don't have as much space. But this is nice. I like the side, you know, spool holder. Although I have shown that trick to do it from the back, but this one's pretty nice. I do like this. And it does come with a full-size spool of filament, 1.75 yellow. That's nice. So before I put this together, I want to take that panel off and see what electronics are inside to see whether it's 8-bit or 32-bit. I flipped the base over so I could get to the electronics. There's a cover over the power supply, and then there's a cover over the electronics, similar to what the Ender 3 has, or Ender 3 Pro, really, because it's come from the bottom. It's got a big fan here, bigger than what's on the Ender 3 or Ender 3 Pro. Hopefully it doesn't mean louder. We'll find out. Now, it does have an 8-bit processor. It's an Atmel. It's a 2560, so it's larger. It's 256K versus 128K of the Ender 3. So there's more memory to put on, you know, auto level or hopefully maybe linear advance. I don't know what's actually in the firmware. They didn't send me that. But the drivers, they have heat sinks on them, and I can't easily take them off because it's really glued in place. I was able to contact Creality, and they confirmed they are 2208 silent stepper drivers. It does have a 30 amp fuse and beefier wires than what's on the Ender 3. And as far as power, it is a meanwhile power supply. It looks very similar to what's on an Ender 3 Pro. It's a 350 watt, 24 volt meanwhile power supply. I assembled this thing in like 10 minutes, so I didn't even really film it. There's four bolts that mount the top to the bottom, just go through the bottom, just like a CR-10. And then there's like five connections. There's two for the stepper motors, one and two at the back. There is a wire for the optical sensor here in the front for Z. That's keyed, so you can't really get it wrong. There's a connector for the LCD touchscreen. That's located, so you can't get that wrong. Two screws to hold it in place. And then there's one continuous ribbon cable. It comes out of the back, goes into that junction box, and continues all the way into the hot end, snaps in place. And then they give you these little spring clips or little snap clips that are reusable to hold everything to the PTFE tube. There is the spool holder. It snaps into the rail. It does pivot. And then the handle. The handle goes on with two screws and T-nuts. So other than that, that was pretty much it. Now, if you're looking for the tools, it's in this drawer at the front. This is a drawer just like what you'd see on most people's Ender 3. You find this on Thingiverse. Well, this is just an injected molded version of the same thing. So now let's look at this hot end because it is unique. I did take it off. Let me show you what that looks like. Two screws. You can take the cover off the hot end, and there's the fan that's blowing down on the filament. Here's the fan that comes off the front of the hot end. It's really kind of a small fan. And then here's the hot end. You can see it's really different design. It's fins, but it's hollow in the right and left. There's a center channel. So that's the new hot end. And it's mounted to this lever arm that can move. And that's where the strain gauge is underneath it. There's a strain gauge that senses that movement. And that's how it does the auto level. The PTFE tube goes all the way down to the nozzle, just like the existing Ender 3 CR-10. No different, but the coupling is different. It's two pieces. One is a screw-in piece, and then there's a snap-in ring that has a metal insert that actually grabs a PTFE tube. So you can snap this out or pop it out. They give you two replacements, and that's what holds the PTFE tube. The nozzle itself is a little different, but it's basically the same size and shape. It's just got some weird look to the top of it. So the one on the right is an Ender 3. The one on the left is what came with this machine. Patreon supporters asked me about build size. It is advertised 235 by 235 by 250. We know the Ender 3 measures 235 by 235, but it's 220 by 220 official build area. Well, this one measures 255 by 245, and you can see it's taller. So this definitely has more build area than an Ender 3. Now let's actually print something. The first thing after turning it on is they recommend you do auto level. So you press auto level, it goes through a 16 point measurement, and then you can adjust the Z offset. So I did the sample print, which is actually a 200% benchy. The first layer went down pretty nice, and then it finished the print. The print looks good. I wouldn't say it's spectacular, but it's pretty good. Patreon supporters wanted to know how loud it is. Well, this is an Ender 3 with two mods, a metal extruder and a silent board. So it's pretty quiet, and this guy is just slightly quieter than an Ender 3 with a silent board. If you have a stock Ender 3, this is a lot quieter. So what about print quality? Well, that 200% benchy, I printed it on this guy. Same filament, same G-code, and they are identical. I wouldn't say they're great. I think it's more slicer than machine, but they're identical. So then I tried a CHEP cube on this guy, just real quick CHEP cube, and I was shocked. It's got terrible ringing on the Y, even some on the X. And then I dug deeper. It turns out the firmware here has the acceleration limited to 500 and the jerk to 10. So I never set that in my start G code. On this guy, it doesn't have that. So I found the jerk of 8 and acceleration of 500 in the G code for this guy. So I put that in my start G code, resliced this, and I redid it with a 200% so I could really see any ringing or any effects. And it's almost none. There's a little bit on the Y, but came out really clean. It looks really good. And this was at my 0.12 profile. I did the same thing in this guy. It's slightly better because there's no glass bed, so there's no ringing whatsoever. But this is really good. Now, I did get warping, So the Z offset was still wasn't right. And I also cleaned the bed. I was worried it wasn't sticking. So then I wanted to try PETG. And so this is the result. It started out good, but it showed signs of warping again and it broke loose and I came back to a ball of string. So I cleaned it one more time and got the same results. It broke off. So I cheated a little bit at that point because this just wasn't working well. I put one swipe of glue, just one swipe of glue stick, zoop, zoop, and got a beautiful benchy out of it. PETG, all I did was use my 0.12 profile, but at 240 degrees C using Prusa's Prusament, and this is a really nice benchy, very clean. So PETG printed just fine. And then I wanted to try NinjaFlex or TPU. Here it is. The real flexible stuff, you know, like a rubber band. Went through this extruder, no issues. I did have to adjust the Z offset one more time because it didn't stick the first layer. And then I got it right. And this just, it printed beautifully. This extruder top is different. It's completely covered. I wish they would have injected molded that clear. So then you could see inside, see the filament, see the, you know, the gear and the idler wheel. And it's just an idler wheel. It's not dual gear. So when you flip this, the whole top pivots. And that releases the wheel from the gear so you can move the filament in and out. And you flip it back and then it locks it back in. And they trap the filament pretty well. And that way you can print like NinjaFlex. There is a unique little screw on the side here that's part of a wedge, and that's how you adjust the tension on the spring. If you do take this apart, it's not easy to put back together. Not impossible, but it's not easy. So it's okay. I still would prefer an EZR over this, but hey, that's my choice. But is it worth it? Creality told me this thing suggested retail price is $429. That seems a bit high to me. Now, it does have auto level built in, but for that, it should have a 32-bit board. And I think that's coming, but I don't know. There's other machines like the Solvol SV01 or the Xfinity Genius. They're very similar to this for about $100 less. Now, both of them have auto level available, BL touch that you have to add. So this one has it, so that would justify it. But the price is $429. This guy with the silent board is about $200 less. Now, I had to install the silent board, but still, for $229 versus $429, I'm getting about the same print quality. So it really comes down to, do you want a machine with auto level, with all these features, ready to go, put together, or do you want a machine that is a kit and that you want to play with? You want to put your own 32-bit board or whatever board on it, your own extruder. That this is really for the tinker and to save some money. This is like a very good starter printer. And you're going to pay a little more, but everything's put together. That's the difference. Now, the real question is, there's also an Ender 3 V2 that I did a video on. I only had a virtual machine. I haven't got my hands on one yet. That falls in between these two. I don't know where that one's going to fit price-wise or what's going to happen there. That's the real mystery to me. But right now, these are the two that are available, although they're taking pre-orders for the V2. When I get one of those, I'll compare it. But this is available on Kickstarter right now. If you can get this for $349 or less, I think it's worth it. But overall, I like it. I think it's a good machine. What do you guys think? Let me know in the comments below. If you like what I'm doing here, maybe check out some of the videos popping up. And please, click on that CHEP logo and subscribe. That way you don't miss an episode. I'll see you next time right here at Filament Friday.